Hyatt Moore paints people, international people, the people of the earth.
Look at the symmetry here. The blue dresses, the yellow, what a portrait.
Having lived on three continents and traveled in over 20 countries, he appreciates the beauty, the dignity, and the value of God's highest creation. One of his most sought-after paintings, The Last Supper with 12 Tribes, integrates his artistic talents and his personal faith, conveying a deep, rich truth.
People have asked me, where'd you get the idea? But I know I had the idea every now and then. If it's something that would come to my mind, and I think, that'd be a crazy idea. But then that would die, and I'd let it go. When would I do that? Why would I do that? But then there's a big mission conference in Vancouver, and I was in charge of coming up with a display, and we had a 20-foot wall to fill. And that's when I thought, you know, if I was ever going to do that, this would be the time. Even then I thought, it's such a crazy idea, and it might be spurious, it might be sacrilegious. People could stumble on this. I thought, maybe I shouldn't do it. But I asked a couple of friends who I knew and knew me, explained the idea, and they said, yeah, go for it. Stop everything. Stop whatever you were doing and do that. That's all the encouragement I needed. The crazy idea was to take the Last Supper painting as Leonardo did it, which is already a little different. You got everybody on one side of the table, but it's famous. Everybody knows that picture. It's an icon now. It's a symbol. Take that same picture and put tribal people at it. This painting is not literal, it's symbolic. It's not about the Last Supper, it's about the next supper, the one where all the tribes of the earth will be invited. I call the painting The Last Supper with 12 Tribes. There are 12 tribes represented. Now there are 6,000 tribes, 6,000 languages, or in the Bible it's called nations, like this. This is 12. If they were all there literally, they couldn't talk to each other because they speak different languages. They could talk to the Lord and He could talk to them, which is one of the wonders. But in fact, they couldn't talk to each other. The tribes that I chose are arbitrary. They're from photos that I had. The one on the extreme left, as you're looking at it, is a Crow Indian from Montana. After that, it's a Berber from North Africa. The standing figure is a Maasai from Kenya. The man in the China hat, well, he's from China. The man with the face paint is from Ecuador. And then the man in the turban is from Afghanistan. It's interesting that when I painted it, Afghanistan wasn't in the news. But right after that, it was very much in the news. And it was interesting to me that I had painted an Afghan right next to Jesus. And of course there's Jesus, and then right next to him is a man from Ethiopia. And after that, a Tsleil-Waututh Indian from southern Mexico. And then we have a man with his hand on the table as a Canela Indian from the jungles of Brazil. The man looking down is from Papua New Guinea. The man with the pigtails is a coastal Salish Indian from British Columbia. And then finally, there's a man from Mongolia. The biggest challenge, and there were lots of challenges, but the biggest one, the one that rather frightened me or intimidated me, was Jesus. One, I didn't have a photo. Two, I never painted Jesus. Never particularly wanted to paint Jesus. It wasn't my intention to make Christian art or religious art at all. It's just that this one called for Jesus. I couldn't not paint him, he had to be there. And so I thought, how do you do this and have nothing to go on? I had Leonardo's picture. I had the posture that he used, the strong triangle and the windows behind. I used that. Of course, he had windows, he had a landscape. I just that sort of sunlight or whatever. I didn't like Leonardo's rendition of the face, if that's what we see anyway. It's been retouched so many times and you don't know what he did. But mine had to be more modern, more up to date. But what? So I was basically sketching it, you know, from the imagination. And so I was very tentative about it. As I was painting a project like this, you're kind of painting all over it. Somebody asked me once, what side did you start at? Like you start on one side and go to the other. It's not how you paint a painting at all. But certainly something like this. You're painting the whole thing all the time. And so I had it all kind of sketched in and Jesus sort of barely there. And I'd be painting along on the right side and then I'd go to the left side and you're walking over here, you paint the Ethiopian for a while, go over here and paint the crow for a while. And then, but every now, as I'd walk back and forth, I'd put a few dabs on the face of Jesus. I thought, you know, I just put a minute's worth in that. I'm not going to go any farther. I don't know. I'll deal with this later. Well, as time went by, it was finished. You know, I'd done enough dabs that it was there. And I thought, well, there it is. I won't touch it anymore. Now, the interesting thing is that the color that he came out, people have said to me, I'm glad you didn't paint him white. Well, I wouldn't have thought of it. At that time, my daughter said, Dad, you don't even know how to paint a white person, because I was always painting these people of color. But it just sort of happened because I was painting him out of the same palette that I was painting all these other people. It was just coming out that way. And so it was natural. And as I've thought about it since, I realized, well, that's what he has done with us. All of the races that we are, all the colors that we are out of the palette that is him. He is created after his own image, and all these colors are in him. When a person looks at this painting, I want them to remember that God has created variety, that he loves all races, and he has invited all of them to his table. People look at it and say, this is, for the first time I understand it. This is what it's going to be like. We're all included. I had one black lady come up to me, and she was a very sophisticated woman, highly educated. She said, this is the first time I have really felt invited. People are stunned by it because of the idea. They hadn't thought of it this way, but as soon as they see it, it's like their mind is open, and they realize that's the kingdom. The kingdom is inclusive. So they want to have it as that reminder. Sometimes they want to have it because they realize this is a piece of art that's relevant to their own perspective on life and hope. It's not just a piece of art, but as a piece of art, they like it too. It's kind of a loose style. But some people want it because it's a conversation starter. You know, anybody that comes over, they're going to say something about that, and they're going to have some response. It'll bring something up, and that's positive. Become my most popular painting. And I've painted many, many paintings since. That was just one painting for one use. But it keeps on going and going and going. And I have no idea where that'll stop or if it'll stop. Leonardo's didn't. He was painting for one thing in one room. And it became, in his lifetime, his most famous piece. Oh, there's a Mona Lisa, etc. It's something about the subject matter. It's something about Jesus blessing this, I think. And Jesus saying, I want this known. I want this known about me. And I didn't know that I would get to record that. We can look back to the Last Supper, but we're looking forward. Even that was pointing to something else. When Jesus at that time, it says there in the Gospels, I have looked forward to this moment. And when you think about it, he's looked forward to this moment since its inception, the beginning of the Passover, of which the Last Supper was the completion. And then he says, and I won't do it again until we do it together in the kingdom. When is that? That's the culmination of all things. That's the marriage feast of the Lamb. And that's what this picture is of. And that's hope. That's what we're aiming toward. We have this historical document that speaks to our spirits and gives us guidance for our lives. But it also points to something yet coming. And that's what this does. And art does something that you can hardly do in words.